kind of like when you watch a horror film and you're saying, don't go outside, don't look, don't go, don't just stay inside and don't open the door. But, you know, she's just kind of blindly, you know, opening these credit cards and doing these things, and you just, yeah, you do just kind of want to rip inside and just pull her out and say, just don't do it, don't do it.
In terms of catfishing, it's another level. You know, it's all very well being a catfish behind your screen, which Simon very much is. You meet him first of all on Instagram. He appears to be exactly who he says he is, sort of an heir to a diamond fortune and a playboy billionaire. But then to go that extra step into the real world and basically create this Truman show of personal assistant, bodyguard, actually flying around in private jets, actually driving around in Lamborghinis or Ferraris or whatever it might be, that was extraordinary for us. Certainly when we first came to the story, I think we didn't quite appreciate just how far the lie, how far the kind of fake reality of this world actually goes.
Simon was presenting himself as a member of the financial elite, like the 0.01% of the world. And none of these women are from that world. So none of them have any idea how life in that world operates. But they believed that Simon was part of that world and that he did understand how all of that operated. You know, we've kind of all seen Succession, which I suppose is the closest thing to what Simon is purporting to be living. And it is lots of dodgy deals and lots of backhanded things going on and ruthless people. So it's not unimaginable that he was under threat. If you Google Simon's name, it brings up, you know, Lev Leviev, who is his father, apparently, being in bed with like Vladimir Putin and people like that. So, you know, when they're doing the searches, everything backs it up.
I think the other thing to throw into the mix, these women, you know, Pernilla, fair enough, it's a friendship, but, you know, for the others, they fall in love with him. And I think that you can't underestimate what love can sort of do. There is a chemical reaction that goes on. We've all done things that perhaps defy rationale a little bit, you know, when we've been in that sort of state of falling in love and it's heady and it's amazing and you're totally swept off your feet. And I think that, you know, certainly for Cecilia and for Eileen as well, is that they fell head over heels for him and they thought that he was feeling the same for them. One of the most shocking moments for me was when we started going through Eileen's WhatsApp messages. You have to read through tons and tons of day-to-day stuff as well as like the key things that you're thinking, this is interesting for the film, this is interesting for the film. We had obviously had Cecilia and Pernilla's and had experienced Simon a little bit ourselves. But what we didn't, I think, appreciate is going through Eileen's WhatsApps and then getting to those voice notes that you hear some of in the film when he totally loses it, when he's, you know, got nowhere else to turn to, where she's not giving him any money back. The way that he unravels at that point, I think, was really shocking.
And you will get the worst fucking enemy you have ever seen in your life, for you and for your fucking family.
I've never felt that Simon was hugely threatening until that point.
Days and days of reading the WhatsApps.
And not just once.
And not just once. And lots of having to kind of take a break from reading them, because it was kind of like, I think I might set fire to these in a second if I don't take a break, because we know what's going to happen. That archive was absolute gold. I mean, that was what sold us both on making this film, because it meant that Simon didn't need to be part of the film. You know, he was so present and we could absolutely show the audience exactly who he was.
The other thing that the WhatsApps allowed was for us to really see the crossover in all of the messages that Simon was sending to one girl, and then straight afterwards on the same day, he'd send the same video in the private jet. Cecilia, my love, I love you, I miss you. And then Eileen, my love, I love you, I miss you. In terms of a timeline, we could really plot out where he was, who he was seeing, what he was doing. And then with the sort of other victims that we've spoken to as well, we've therefore been able to say, oh, look, he was saying to Cecilia there that he's in Berlin or wherever on a business meeting, but actually, you know, we've spoken to another victim in that country and we know that that's what he was doing there. We didn't want this to be a platform for Simon to tell any more lies or tell a sob story, to make excuses. We knew that we wanted this to be a platform for the women, an enormous global platform for these women to tell their story, because the VG article just proved how successful exposure of a guy like this can be. Without the VG article, then other victims wouldn't have known. Eileen would never have known who she was dating. With Eileen, she felt so unempowered throughout this whole thing, and she was really, really reluctant to speak to us, to go on camera. She felt so ashamed. And, you know, with gentle encouragement from Bernie and just amazing support, first she was going to do an interview, but anonymously. And then she said, OK, no, I'll go on camera.
He never believed that I was capable of doing this. He knows now. Hi, Simon.
We were just thrilled when she did her little hi, Simon. We just felt, you know, go Eileen, and you should feel really pleased and proud of yourself, because she's badass and he underestimated her. Behind the scenes, Eileen actually still has quite a lot of his clothes. And so the clothes that you see in the film that are being ironed and so on that we used in a recon are Simon's actual clothes.
Wish we could watch him watch it.
I hope he watches it, yeah.